Admission is $15, magic letter in the jackpot additionals at $5, three early birds at $50, and 17 regulars at $75. Jackpot, 54 numbers or less, 1,000, constellation 500. Sold separately, wild ball, double, WTA top or bottom, letter T at 100. Left to right, straight line, 50-50. Kitchen is open. You must be at least 12 years of age to be admitted. Anyone admitted must pay the admission price to the bingo at South Brownsville. The VFC on Water Street, Brownsville. Doors open at 5:15. Early bird 6:45. Regular games at 7. It's off paper bingo. That's South Brownsville bingo each and every Wednesday at their fire hall on Water Street. And I'm Nick wishing you a great day and the best of bingo luck.
Thanks for joining us on Radio Bingo. Heard weekday mornings at 10:10, weekday evenings at 11:20, and Saturday mornings at 7:10. If your organization would like to be featured on Radio Bingo, call our sales staff today at 724-438-3900. That's 438-3900. Radio Bingo, heard exclusively on your local station, 590 AM, 101.1 FM, WNBS, Uniontown.
At Montgomery Medical, they have a team of dedicated medical providers for you to meet. Led by Dr. Marcy Goyce, trust their 50 years of combined experience for the best results in primary care. Newborns to elderly, minor illness or injury, as well as wellness and physical exams. Same-day appointments available for acute care as well. Montgomery Medical, a family tradition of family medicine. Hours available from 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Thursday, 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. on Friday, and 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. on Saturday. Located at 100 Bridgeview Drive, Suite 3, Smithfield, Pennsylvania, 15478. Call 724-569-8100 or visit MontyMed.com to schedule your appointment today. That's 724-569-8100. Or visit MontyMed.com to schedule your appointment today. Now accepting new patients.
This is The Great Outdoors with Jason White, exploring the great outdoors in Pennsylvania and beyond. Brought to you by the Mariana Outdoorsmen Association and by Wild Acres Farm, Fishery, and Regulated Hunting Grounds. Now, The Great Outdoors with Jason White.
Good morning, folks, and welcome to The Great Outdoors. I'm covering for Jason White. He had a very serious operation, and we wish him the best of in a quick recovery. My name is The Whipster. I'm here later in the afternoon on Wednesdays with the Dog Tag Program, 3:15 to 4 o'clock. So tune in for what we're doing with the issues with veterans and awareness and educating, hopefully. In the meantime, though, you can hear us on 590 AM, 101.1 FM, streaming live on Facebook, and those who know the internet, it's WNBS590.com, broadcasting live out of Uniontown, Pennsylvania. And again, I have a friend that's going to be with me, Denny. Why don't you jump in there and introduce yourself?
Okay, thank you. First of all, Whip and Nick, I want to thank you for giving us the opportunity to be on your program today. My name is Denny Gutierrez, and to tell you a little bit about myself, I had a history in sales and management as a career position. I used to complain about how things were in politics, and why isn't this getting done, and why isn't that getting done. But I realized that complaining is not going to solve any problems. So I decided to run for local council, which I did. And it turned out to be quite rewarding and educational. And through that process, I was able to meet people like Whip here and Jason White, and became acquainted with them, and ended up working with the MOA. I'm on the board with that outfit. But what I wanted to explain was, when I got into politics, people expect you to do everything. They expect you to fix all the problems in the community and so forth. And I soon realized that the first year in politics, you're kind of lost. You're just learning your way through the job, to learn the procedures and the different committees and so forth. and you're somewhat limited, and after 2 years, you're starting to feel comfortable, and there is quite a bit to be done in the office of council or township supervisor position. You have committees that you're involved with that take a lot of time, and it's a full-time job. And if you have a full-time job, you're doing this on your spare time. So you are somewhat limited. So what I'm leading to is the fact that don't expect your local government to do everything for you. Get involved, and you can make some very good changes. There's choices you have. You can either get into politics, run for an office, or you could be a part of a committee or create a committee to search for your or to achieve your projects or things that you would like to see changed in the community. And the local officials would gladly appreciate you being involved in a committee to do these things because they cannot do everything. Their time is limited, and they have other obligations, but they welcome committees. And if your local committee or your local officials would appreciate someone creating a committee and getting involved, and we're going to get into that in a little more detail throughout the program, but hopefully we can bring some useful knowledge that you could take away and use in your own communities and so forth if you so choose. And through my career, I approach things that I didn't know about, different areas of expertise that I wasn't familiar with, I would consult people that were. And successful people are happy to share their success with you if you show a sincere interest in their particular area. So that's what I always did, and then I would ask for their advice and so forth, and then I would close my mouth and listen, and they would gladly share their knowledge with you so they could help you succeed. So I'm just putting this out there for you in case you're entertaining some thoughts on getting involved in your community, in which which we could all use help in all our communities. So given that, through my years in local politics, which I am not involved anymore, but I came across some very, very interesting contacts. And one of those people I have with me today. And we always talk about the Mon Valley and how bad things are. And we talk about Monongahela and say that Monongahela is the only town that seems to be doing well. Well, that wasn't good enough for me. I wonder why are they doing well. So I contacted a friend that I met through my association in local politics, and he plays a big role in the success of Monongahela. And I invited him along today to share some of his wisdom and knowledge with us. And I'm going to turn the mic over to him at this point, and his name is Terry Neccai, and he has played a great role in the success of Monongahela, and he's happy to share that with us. So, Terry, would you please?
Thank you, Dennis. That was very nice. I usually start off with a little bit of my background, but I'm pretty dyed-in-wool Monongahela, Mon Valley, Western Pennsylvania person, but although my family was in Fayette County in the 1700s on my mother's side. I studied architecture and have a license and a degree, professional degree in architecture. It's been about 42 years since I finished my architectural education and about 30-some years since I became a licensed architect. But I went to school in Pittsburgh, and I would come home on the weekends, and Monongahela is just this little small town that's actually a real city. It has a city charter, and it is Pennsylvania's second smallest municipality with a city charter. But as I was growing up, we had a lot of city things, like New York City-style taxis and movie theaters. The last one was still operating when I was 10, and a bunch of us hired a taxi cab and went down the hill and went to the theater for 50 cents each and 50 cents for the cab ride. And I think it's great to have the kind of community where a 10-year-old can say that. So that mattered a lot to me. My mother worked downtown in the bank. My grandfather on my mother's side was a contractor and was involved in building a lot of the buildings. And I didn't realize how much I loved our downtown until it started to disappear in the 1970s. We used to do things in the United States through programs called urban renewal or redevelopment. And back in those days, it was undevelopment. The federal government allocated enough money to the towns in Washington County, including Canonsburg, Washington, Charleroi, Denora, to do a lot of demolition. And in Monongahela's case, they allocated enough money for a plan to demolish 8 acres of our downtown, and we lost 60 buildings. And we now have 52 old buildings left. So coming out of architectural school, I was, I had been in love with these buildings and didn't even realize it. We didn't learn anything about American architecture or history or preservation in my degree. It was all about designing new buildings. But I understood the concepts of how a main street can be shaped and how buildings can play off of each other and build a great character and so forth off of each other. And even kooky little things, like we had a building burned down in World War II and somebody put a little tiny diner there that looked totally out of place, but that actually added character. When we cleared the entire slate for a couple blocks, that was actually what I would call an architect's nightmare, because you can't really design anything that relates to the rest of the composition. You're just designing something like a duck that you're sticking in the middle of a field. And so I wanted to get involved in how do you turn that around. So Denny started off talking about nonprofit groups. He said committees or organizations. And I got involved in our local historical society and a local arts group, and I tried to find ways as a 23-year-old to make a difference there, and made a few enemies fighting over historic buildings because the demolition projects continued for about 5 or 10 more years. But we learned about I learned, first of all, about preservation ideas, like how do you get something on the National Register and how do you get people to say that shouldn't be changed. Those are the more restrictive, or even the National Register, restrictive is not the right word, but they're geared towards slowing down change. They're reactive. But there's a national program that was starting just then called the Main Street Program. And we have a program, we have an organization in the United States called Main Street America, or the National Main Street Center. There are two names for the same thing, a division of the National Trust for Historic Preservation. And their philosophy was, well, maybe that change is supposed to happen. You just encourage it to happen in the right way. You don't tear down, two or three blocks like we did and then let them sit vacant. Or in our case, 19 buildings became a parking lot with a McDonald's in the middle. That's where my movie theater was that we went to when I was 10. It's right across the street from where my mother worked when I was 5. So this idea was out there to start a Main Street program, and I want to tell you the basics of a Main Street program are that the number one probably message or lesson in the Main Street program was you don't separate architecture from community activity and economics. You have to do it all together. My parents used to say, oh, we have a Chamber of Commerce. It's too bad they didn't bring Sears or Penny's in to save everything. Well, you don't look for an outside savior. You look for local commitment. And maybe a big corporation will want to be there, but they're not as important as all those little businesses that people start that go to the bank and keep their money local and pay local people. So that's one principle. Another is that back in the 70s, everybody thought it was just architecture. You fix it up, do a nice ribbon-cutting picture, you walk away, and, you built it, they'll come. It doesn't work that way. You actually have to do as much architecture with the people and the organizations as you do with the buildings themselves. So the Main Street Program works on something called the four-point approach, where you organize. Number one principle is organization. Second one is promotion. Promote the downtown is the place to be. And back to organization for a second. Build a new organization in the core that is willing to cooperate with all the other organizations and tries to build cooperation and joint ventures and things like that. and has all its proper paperwork as a 501c3 or some other kind of organization. And sometimes it's a division of the city or something like that. And then you go on to fixing the design issues, the buildings, the facades, the lighting, the sidewalks, the signs, the logos, the graphics, the menus. Do you have outside dining tables? Are you going to have flowers in your flower planters or just weeds? Are you going to clean up the litter? All of those are design issues. Monongahela has just done some wonderful things with some new lighting on some poles that were put in 40 years ago. The poles were antique style, but the light on the top didn't shed very much light, and the glass got dirty, and they came up with a new way to change the top with a historic-looking top that's a lot brighter, but it has LED in it. Those kinds of things. That's a design question. Or we've added a lot of wheelchair ramps in Monongahela. PennDOT did them along Main Street because it's a state highway. And we have one family, or one of our city council members actually went out and got a grant to do the second street back from Main Street with wheelchair ramps. So we're a very accessible community. So we have a new family that just moved there from Knoxville, Tennessee. The woman has been in a wheelchair since she was little. She says she has never lived in such an accessible place. And if it hadn't been for, you know, Kenny making that decision to apply for that grant and put those wheelchair ramps on Chess Street, who knows? We also, you know, pretty well known, have a couple of great event venues, the Aquatorium and Chess Park, which has a beautiful bandstand gazebo and some brick streets. And the farmer's market occurs every Friday afternoon at Chess Park. We have a wonderful farmer's market, well organized. The Aquatorium is a 3,700-seat amphitheater looking out into the river. And you have to, you know, change the impressions and everything along with all of this. The fourth point of the Main Street program, is, of course, I said it was organization, promotion, and design, is economic vitality. And I always put that last, partly because I'm an architect. I don't start with a marketing plan. I start with the visuals. But also, the economic vitality comes out of all of those things. And so it's not just about forcing economics or calculating economics. It's about encouraging people to start businesses and encouraging a buildup of a critical mass of things happening in your community. So we wanted to start a Main Street program in the early 80s. In 1982, when we first started talking about it, myself and several friends, I'm now the executive director, but that's the next part of the story, we couldn't figure out how to do it. There weren't any others right around here, but it was a movement spreading across the country. There were three Main Street programs in the 1970s that by 1980 grew into 36. And one of the first 36 was Uniontown. There were six states that were chosen in order for them to be the models for the rest of the country. And each of the six states had six towns. And in Pennsylvania, they were Jim Thorpe and Uniontown and Titusville. And I could probably name a couple others. And those became kind of the bedrock, the beginnings of the program. But by 1982, when we were talking about it, we could have been the 40th town in America or the 50th. And yet it was really hard for us because we had such a small city entity, and our city council wasn't in favor of preservation. They knew how to tear buildings down, and they weren't in favor of adding grassroots things. They brought McDonald's in, you know, which is a big corporation that banks out of town and pays low wages, you know, but it filled up space. And so we were trying to figure out how to do this. And so with the local historical society, we did a bunch of publications, and I had a newspaper column, so similar to this show today. We were trying to get through with media to build a following. It's kind of exciting to me. I would go to Pittsburgh on the bus for a job there as an apprentice architect, and I was watching other people on the bus read my column from the day before in the Daily Republican. We still had a daily newspaper back then. Anyhow, over the years, we talked about it so much that a lot of people wanted to do parts of it. Nobody seemed to want to do the whole program. So we had a community development corporation that was organized, and they eventually started doing a lot of events. Our Chamber of Commerce stayed downtown focused, although there were times when I was worried they would do what a lot of other chambers did and become more regional and more about malls and things. They're still focused on our downtown, and they still do with the six biggest events in town. Our historical society does a lot of grassroots activities and events and things like that. our veterans groups do also, with the parades and those kinds of things, and meals. We have organizations like the VFW and the Elks that do community meals, and the Methodist Church is still doing a spaghetti dinner fundraiser 8 times a year, which it's not in-house anymore, it's takeout. But when it was in-house, nobody ran for political office without being at that spaghetti dinner because it was that important. That's the kind of stuff that builds up this critical mass. But we were in an unusual situation because back in the Corbett years, about 15 years ago, the state adopted a policy that you're supposed to raise 5 years of funds before you start a Main Street program. And most Main Street programs have a budget of about $50,000 a year. You're required to have a paid staff member. And you can't, you know, you can maybe find someone in this region in the 30,000 range, 40,000 range, but in Philadelphia it's 60 or 70,000. I went out and got the experience as a Main Street manager, and I just said, I'll donate, which is against some of the rules, but we've gradually gotten to the place where I'm paid a little bit. I'm retirement age, so maybe it'll be somebody else in a year or two will be paid. But we had to join a moving train. So 8 years ago, a bunch of us started meeting as a Main Street program board, and oh my goodness, I didn't realize, I had moved away for a while and moved back. In 2018, I did a community calendar that I would hand out at meetings, and I listed everything I could find out about going on in town. And in 2018, I tracked 900 activities going on in that 1 year by these 20 or 30 other organizations. We didn't need to add any activities to promote the town. We just needed to promote the ones that were going on. We did eventually add a couple. And then the pandemic came. We had a grant actually to do a couple more activities, and all of a sudden we couldn't use it on that, so we had to come up with creative things. We made photographs of all the high school students and put them in the store windows to connect the school to the downtown. We made open signs when the stores gradually opened. We put flowers out. We bought tables and chairs to put on the sidewalk so there would be sidewalk dining. And that was all because of the pandemic, but we weren't going to spend the money initially on tables and chairs. So we're gradually, and the city at one point said, oh, the sidewalk dining is okay, and then they changed their mind, and now they've changed their mind back. So we're kind of plugging for that kind of progress and moving forward in that way. And so it's been a long process, and it involves thousands of people because these other 20 organizations are putting on so many things. The Aquatorium has rock concerts over the summer. I think there are 8 this year on Saturdays. At our gazebo, the Mon Valley Academy for the Arts puts on band concerts on Sundays. They just did one. They also come every week. They come once a month on Sunday, but they come every week to the farmers market. And they get money to pay the musicians. That's really cool. The Aquatorium has beverages, and like beer and things, and they'll get 200, 300, or 3,000 people at a weekend show. But after the pandemic, the thing that astounded me was that people think of the Mon Valley, they hear Monongahela, they think we're part of the steel industry. We were always a small city we're 100 years older than all the steel and glass towns. We were there as a small city with a lot of diversity of lot sizes, business types, diverse downtown, lots of different economically diverse opportunities. And the pandemic led to no shows, no activities for a year. The first concert that occurred at the Aquatorium after it was possible to have a show again drew 49 yachts to the Monongahela Aquatorium. They were tied together in a bank, and somebody has a drone photography business who went up in the air and took a picture of all of it. It was like, wow, this is not what people think of. And I think all the one industry things, the outside corporations, the job creation questions, those are all fine. That we come from that kind of an extraction industry and steel making and coal industry. But you know what? We also had a downtown for each one of these communities, and we had this kind of economic diversity in every town. It's just that Monongahela never relied on one major industry while all of its neighbors did. So I hope that what we're learning, we're able to teach to other people. That's why I'm excited to be here today and to just tell this. I will make one more plug, and then maybe we'll dialogue a little. I go into monologue too much. But on July 4th, we will be having a street fair for the youth. It's a youth-driven event with about 20 booths, about six food booths. It's called the Railroad Street Fair, put on by the Monongahela Youth Main Street Program, which is also called My Main Street, MY for Monongahela Youth. It's from 6 to 9 p.m. on 3rd Street, which is right in the center of town next to our new ice cream shop and next to PNC Bank. The ice cream shop's called Sweets by Mrs. C. And at 9:45, there will be fireworks at the Aquatorium. So they've been doing that for 50 years. It draws about 5,000 people into the downtown area and another 5,000 into the perimeter of town to watch the fireworks from the hilltops. So come and visit Monongahela on July 4th. In the last 5 years, progress in Monongahela has not slowed down. We have had over 50 small new businesses open, including some clothing stores, an ice cream shop, a deli, a downtown bakery, a horse tech place, a Christmas shop, a candle shop, a soap shop. We used to be more antique shops. We still have some great antique shops. And there's just a lot to do. So come and visit. We are almost down to no vacant spaces. And come and visit and bring some of these ideas back to your own community, because I think that's what we all need to do.
Wow. That's amazing, Terry. I tell you, I'm sitting here trying to take notes, and I've gotten so many questions to ask you. And number one, the whole theme about the Aquatorium, that's outdoors.
Right.
And with the boating and everything. So that in itself, with the outdoor activities, it brings a different positive reaction to people that they do want to do build in to, you know, the tie-in. And the efforts that you put in with the, as well as your committee, is absolutely awesome. And what I find amazing is that you're talking about different agencies and organizations. That's a hat trick in itself to bring all these groups together and to form one idea.
It's really hard to keep them from trying to compete instead of cooperate.
Yes, that's what I was getting at.
You need both in a downtown. You also need competition between stores.
Well, a healthy competition.
Right.
But also, what you had mentioned about the dedication and the, you know, some days you're down in the valley and say, man, what am I doing? I'm not getting, it just seemed like I'm not going nowhere with it. And then all of a sudden, you know, it springboards what you had just expressed with all these activities of, you know, concerts, eight bands coming in at various times, the street fair, the fireworks, the new businesses. My goodness, guy, are you one or?
No, we had 16 or 17 people at our board meeting last night. We have lots of people.
But see the dedication there. It's all. It's like an epidemic.
Our past president was born the year we were starting all this, you know. He's 33, you know, Tobias, 33
sure,
or 34
sure.
years old.
Great,
yeah. He was born after we started it.
But, now, is there a website or is there any?
Oh, yeah, we have a great website, Monongahela Main Street Program. Dan Trigembo's our webmaster. I do a newsletter on Facebook most of the time every Friday. I've been a little less frequent lately. It can be 12 pages of typing and a list of all the businesses included. And Dan edits that a little bit and puts it on the Facebook page. I mean, on the website, but it's also on Facebook for you.
Okay, and your Facebook page is
Monongahela Main Street Program, both
okay,
of them.
Okay, both of them. Same dealings.
The other one, the website is technically msp.org or something, but if you Google Monongahela Main Street Program, you'll get it.
Okay. Now, let me ask you, going back to the, you had mentioned you were going to have a July 4th,
right.
Event. What time does that start?
6 to 9 p.m.
6 p.m. to 9 p.m.
We have things for little kids. We have a grab bag game for little kids to buy from each other. We have, we're hoping to have the demonstration beehive. That depends on how much honey the local beekeeper gets. But he brings a demonstration beehive. A live mural will be painted during the event by Rivers of Steel Arts. In the past, we've had the horn machine, which is an invention in Monongahela, kept in a building in Gallatin. It's not coming this year, but it's made out of the foghorns from different steel mills and glass factories, and they've all played different notes on an air compressor. He has to go around the block because he would blow out everybody's ears. It's so loud. And you can hear it 5 to 7 miles away. But we do cool things. Like our town grew up around a tavern that started about 1770. That's 6 years before the Declaration of Independence. We have one farm left inside the city limits. The people at that farm do great cool history type things. They bring their horses down the hill and deliver the Declaration of Independence to Parkinson's Tavern, and we read the Declaration of Independence to kick off the event. We also commemorate the first train that came on July 4th, 1874. You know, we do cool things like that to get the kids interested in history.
Oh, that's great. And being today is Flag Day, I've got a couple questions to ask you guys. Why did they pick June 14th for recognizing it as a Flag Day holiday?
I'm going to let Denny talk about that.
Part of the Constitutional Convention.
A little too far.
Oh, part of the Constitutional Convention, I understand, but Whip has far more info on it than I do.
Oh, you're going to throw it back in my lap.
Yes, sir.
Well, you're absolutely right. That's when they authorized, the Continental Congress authorized and approved the flag as being a part of our great nation. That was dedicated in June 14th, 1777. So you passed the mark on that one.
Yes, sir.
But I'll go ahead and add more to it. One more, Terry. Going back to this event on July 4th, can outsiders or somebody, can they get in touch with you guys and be a vendor or such?
Oh,
or?
Yeah. We still have room. We have about 20, 25 vendors lined up, but half of those are demonstrations. It's free if you do a demonstration without sales.
Okay.
We have about 6 food booths lined up, and one of them is a VFW. Another one's going to have tacos. One's going to have funnel cakes, lemonade. We hope to have a lemonade stand with little kids this year. We're hoping to have pizza. But we also have some young people that make crafts and things, and we've had older people that make crafts that are of interest to young people.
I like it. I like it.
I want to comment on the outdoors aspect.
Go ahead.
I'm an outdoors person. I love to go primitive camping. I'm not a sports person except for camping and bicycling. And I'm not an athlete, but I bicycle around town all the time. But I never thought of our downtown as primarily an outdoors. That's the opposite, you know, kind of thing. But the Aquatorium has made us more about the outdoors.
Absolutely.
Chess Park Gazebo and the concerts are outdoors. All these things are also generally rain or shine. You know, some people listening might know about the Flea Teaks, which are 13-block long flea markets we do the first Saturday in June and October, or our light up night that we do a week before Thanksgiving. They all draw thousands of people. But this year we're doing a project with Walkworks, which is a Pennsylvania program to encourage each town to have a plan to be more walkable, bikeable, better for wheelchairs, and better for bus use. We have great bus service in Monongahela. 57 plus buses a day go through Monongahela. And there are 2 transit authorities. One's Mon Valley and one is Washington County. The Washington County one does special trips for wheelchairs and things, and they do ride sharing and courthouse trips. The other ones are commuter buses going in and out of Pittsburgh and to some of the places where there are jobs. Meanwhile, we've got this grant this year to do this Walkworks study, and we are actually looking at, can we put in more wheelchair ramps? Should we consider something like a bike lane or just share the road arrows? Could we have some better crosswalks? Do we need more bike racks? What about the broken sidewalks? All that stuff is being under study. And anybody that has an opinion, there's a survey that's on you can fill out on our city website. There's a link that gets you to the survey and an interactive map. But the one thing I wanted to say, I'm always kind of pulling it back to something philosophical or esoteric. All of a sudden, the buildings kind of faded back a little bit, and I started seeing the stuff in between the buildings. You know, my interest was the historic buildings to begin with. But it's not just decorative details on historic buildings. Does it all work together as a composition, and do we have the accessibility? We have a high-rise that I do not like, built in the 1980s. It's 1950s style. It's 10 stories tall, right in the middle of town. It was placed there almost by accident because they planned it for a different site. Young people love this building. It looks like it's right out of the Jetsons, like it just flew in. You know?
Yes.
But the main thing is that the Housing Authority has made that into the facility for people in wheelchairs. And we have a lot of people in motorized wheelchairs, including veterans in motorized wheelchairs.
Well, I want to compliment you on that, that you are using the guidelines of the ADA, and that's the American Disability Act, mm-hmm. and you know, making the inclusion and making it accessible, especially with the curbs, to where they can take and you know find that curb to where they can continue on without any assistance. If they now, naturally, there's people there that would want to help. But you already taken that and incorporated it, not only for the outside, but all the other activities that you're involved with.
I think also it's important to desegregate people. The high-rise and the people in wheelchairs kind of, I didn't know them until we did this study. And now I know them by name. I see them on the street all the time.
Yes.
So now we're painting park benches, and we needed electricity, and we didn't do the one in front of the high-rise yet. But I said, where are we going to get? I don't want to ask the housing authority for a favor. You know, they might say no electric, you know, someone will trip on the cord. The people in the high rise said, don't worry, just get really long extension cords. We'll run it out with the windows and the wheelchairs can go underneath.
Yeah.
I'm thinking of selling advertising space on the extension cord.
Yeah, there you go.
I just mentioned something here since we're on the subject of Monongahela and events. I belong to a car club called the Bonafide Builders, and we're a collection of highly skilled craftsmen that build. We have one member that actually built his own body out of an old Packard, and it looks like an old speedster that you'd find on the speedway. When we have everything from hot rods to muscle cars to rat rods and so forth. But we are holding a car cruise this Friday night. And it's at the First Baptist Church parking lot, 601 West Main Street, Monongahela. It's across from the park. And it will go on from 4 to 8 p.m. So if you're interested, if you're a car person like I am, and you want to stop by and check out the vehicles, please do.
Thank you for adding one more thing we'll have to promote now.
Well, that's a good one.
You can see Monongahela is full of activities.
Yep. And I'm hoping. Now, that leads me into another question. If there is somebody interested in, like, in the mainstream or street.
Main Streets program.
Yeah. And they want to adopt that, I'm sure that you would give assistance.
I would love to talk to them. I want to see more of these around Western Pennsylvania. But it is a nonprofit organization that there's a national nonprofit. Sometimes the local one is a city division or something like that that's not nonprofit. And the state has a nonprofit that's state funded that helps you set one up. And they want you to do it through the authorized channels. I've also known communities that did it without the state. Generally, it's a full-time job for somebody, and they have training and meetings. We'll be going to the conference. In fact, I'm not supposed to announce it. We may be getting an award at the conference this year in Scranton in 2 weeks. We've gotten a couple of the statewide awards for things that we've done, even though we're probably the smallest by far budgeted program in Pennsylvania. But I can also tell you how to do that. I can tell you how to do it at a small budget, you know. Yes, and I'd love to see more of this. You really need to have a critical mass of people that are interested in your downtown because they're going to have to chip in, you know, but build that interest.
Yes, but the reward is that the mall and Paul stores would come back mm-hmm. and the variety like
there's
you had.
There's a renaissance
mentioned.
Going on, not just in Monongahela, all over the country.
Yeah, right. And that's that's the main.
That's what we all went back to.
Yeah.
We're tired of malls.
Yeah. Well, that and again, that whole avenue of thought is prosperity back to the towns.
I read an article recently where somebody said, you know, the thing about mom and pop stores, it's like gardening. You're planting a seed, you're growing, you're raising it gradually, you're keeping it watered, you're taking some pride in it, you're talking to it, you know, it's yours. If you bring in big corporations, that's like mining. They come in, they take out all your money and put it in a bank somewhere else, and they pay you low-paying jobs. You know, so even if the mom-and-pop stores are barely surviving or whatever, it's worth it to try to support them and try to build them up because they're your family, they're your local bank customer, they're your local traffic. They're so, better paid jobs eventually.
Well said. And another thing that struck me about your conversation, the inclusion of the farmers market.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that there in itself, there is a program I believe that even Fayette County is going to have from later in a couple months from now, from farm to table. And you guys are doing it already each and what? How?
It's every Friday from 3 to 6 from June until September.
There you go. There you go. So,
and I don't run it. It's very well run, and it's expanded. It almost died a couple years ago, but it's actually very well run now. And please come and visit us.
Well,
on Friday.
The exposure of it is bringing people in to support that.
Yeah, and it's local farmers, local produce.
Yeah, and I believe that Fayette County is adopting that same. I'm not too well versed in that area. I've got to explore, you know, get more information. But I understand bits and pieces that they are engaged in, you know, promoting as such. And I like what you said, promoting, you know, and it's like throwing mud on a wall. Soon enough, something's going to stick.
We all grew up in houses. If you had a bunch of kids, you might have each had your own bedroom or shared a bedroom, but you went to the living room to get together, or you went to the dining room to have dinner.
Yeah.
That's what downtown is. It's your big living room for the whole family. It's supposed to have walls and details and so forth, so that it actually has character, but it's the character that's the supreme living room of the whole downtown, of the whole community.
Yeah, definitely. And Denny, I have to make comment about what you had mentioned about working with the political people and the different agencies, that where if you bring a good idea to them, that they'll more or less support it and help fund it, even to the point which leads me to give a shout out to our Fayette County commissioners, as well as our Fayette County VA director. We have a Veterans Crisis Line that serves both for the non-veteran as well as the veteran themselves in a time of need. When you see a change or a transformation of that person, personality or whatever, that 988 is nationwide. And when we brought that to the attention of our Fayette County commissioners, they all three of them jumped on board to say, "Okay, we need some visuals for both in banners as well as the yard sign type, you know." So we established that, and we got to give them and you're spot on about, you know, bringing something to the commissioner, because they have a whole variety of agencies they got to deal with, the planning stages of, you know, what's going on in projects, and again,
they're willing to help.
That's right. And we're not talking, you know, again, I don't care if you're Republican, Democrat,
it does not matter
when you're talking and trying to preserve somebody's life, in this case 988, and some of the programs, like with what they also did was with our MOA dog tag program through the VA of our Fayette County, and we've had others, but I got to take, and they've promoted sponsorship that we utilized our Fayette County veterans to come over to the MOA to enjoy that buildup of a community and the whole variety of programs, which I'll explain later on our show, but it's all outdoor activity. And with what Terry said, of what Mon City is doing, Monongahela, there's a lot of basis of outdoor activity that where it just fills, you know, that positive impact that being there for, you know, the enjoyment of car shows, the enjoyment of the farm market.
We're very walkable and bikeable too.
Yeah.
And we have great nature things all around us. The hillside across the river from Monongahela is Allegheny County. It's like a wall of trees that you see all the time when you're in Monongahela, Mon City. It's actually a nature preserve owned by the Allegheny Land Trust and Western Pennsylvania Conservancy.
Well, see what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so it all ties in.
Stuff that's outdoors.
It all ties in to the well-being of a human being that they enjoy this. That's why they're coming, like you say, in groves that... You've had an event where they had springboarded almost 10,000 people be just a visual of it. You know what I mean?
And we have a new tie flying shop fly fishing fishermen.
Yes, yes.
right downtown and within a block or two of the river, where the river's beautiful. The aquatorium provides shelter for the fish. And they're going to lower the river next year. They're going to take out the dam at Elizabeth, and they're going to redesign the aquatorium. And it was just in the paper yesterday, they're adding reefs all along the Monongahela River to make sure the fish are protected when the river lowers down. But that's going to make it a different experience from what it is right now, maybe better for boating and things.
And they're keeping you updated on that, or you, you're interacting?
The city is interacting with them a lot.
Oh,
I'm not
wonderful.
A city official, but yes. And it was in the paper yesterday, Mon Valley Independent.
Well, guys, I'll tell you, we're in our closing minutes, and we, again, want to let the folks know that Jason is recovering from a very serious surgery. And, Denny, I want to thank you as well as Terry. And go ahead.
I got a minute. I would just like to thank Whip for the opportunity to be on today. And
same for me.
Hopefully, we gave some useful knowledge that you can use in your everyday lives. And if you did like this program, please let us know. So let us know if you'd like to hear more of this and get back to the studio here.
Well, share that on Facebook.
Or if you need some more advice from Terry, we'd be glad to help you.
I'd be glad to hear from you.
And I'll cut this short because Whip's trying to close. But,
all right, guys.
Thank you.
Shopping Monongahela.
That's The Great Outdoors on your local station, WMBS Uniontown.
Sponsored by Progressive Insurance.
I'm Steve Kathan. Rising interest rates have put many home buyers in a squeeze.
Almost feels like it's impossible to buy a home.
CBS's Sarah Ewall Weiss reports today the Federal Reserve is expected to pump the brakes.
The federal funds rate currently sits between 5 5.25% after 10 consecutive interest rate hikes, which have raised borrowing costs.